people in Arkansas had never heard of AIDS, much less known someone with the disease.
It hit the community of Hot Springs hard, with many of the patients losing friends and family when they found out they were positive.
And there was no one there to care for them or even bury them. That is, until Ruth Coker Burks decided to do something about it.
Yeah, Ruth is now retired, but she lives in Rogers, and this is her amazing story of compassion.
Please.
Here, take them. Keep them away from me.
Afraid they'll make you fat?
No, actually. I haven't gained a pound in 3.5 years. They just... My father, he used to love Oreos, so I think of him when I eat them.
I only like the cream.
I bet.
Shush, Matthew, it's Christmas!
It doesn't feel much like Christmas. No twinkly lights, no tree, not even real Christmas cookies.
Honey, I tried. I went out to the store to get the ingredients, but one aisle in it and I was already winded. I just grabbed Nara's cookies and barely made it back to the car. I just get so tired so easily.
Well, I'm not blaming anyone or anything, just thinking out loud. Who could that be?
Callers. And me without my face on.
Merry Christmas!
What is all this?
Santa asked me to help make sure everyone on his list got everything he wanted to give them, so here I am.
Oh, this is too much, Ruth.
Nonsense. It's the least we could do. Everyone deserves a little Christmas.
How about some Yuletide nosh?
Mama, can I have this?
Listen, guys, I'm just gonna say it. I've been doing this for a while now, and my logical side says that glass is perfectly safe. It's been washed, and if there were any trace of the virus, the soap and hot water killed it. But I have this illogical, frightened mother's side that still hears the words from the beginning of this crisis and the fear we all felt. I taught Allison to be careful, not mean. I'm just trying to figure out.
Ruth, stop. Sit down. We understand. You've done so much for us. How could we think you didn't care about us just because you're a mama who's worried about her daughter?
I just want to lead by example.
And you have. In so many ways. There's still so much we don't know, even living with it every day.
Thank you for being so understanding.
Thank you for all of this.
Well, I have one mission and one mission alone.
Tinsel! Tinsel everywhere! Allison, come help your Uncle Matthew.
Okay.
TJ, how are you doing?
All better mostly. My medicinal cocktail finally seems balanced, so overall feeling better.
I'm glad to hear that.
AIDS makes for a pretty crappy Christmas.
It was actually Christmas 4 years ago that I first heard of AIDS. I was in Hawaii on vacation, staying with my cousin who lives in Honolulu. I'd heard of this disease that was killing gay men and killing them fast. It was called GRID then, gay-related immune deficiency. I was so scared for my dear cousin Raymond. He was young and gay. I asked him about this disease. He told me that it was okay, that it only hit gay men in San Francisco. Later that following spring, I went to visit my friend Kathy in the hospital. I was a champion hall pacer, and I paced and paced and paced.
Jimmy's buried right about there. He's the very first AIDS patient I ever had.
Well, it looks like Mrs. Stewart's battles aren't for being good news. Now, someone's gonna need to go in and check on Mr. Cook. Who's it gonna be?
Not me.
I'd rather not.
I did it last. I have 2 kids at home. I can't risk it.
Who would take care of my cats?
Cats?
Ladies, ladies, stop fighting. We'll settle this the way we have every time he's been here. Now, everybody takes one and no complaining about the outcome. Bless me. Thank goodness. No, you can't force me to go in there. Best 2 out of 3. I can, and I will.
I think I hear Mrs. Stewart asking for ice chips.
Fine, we'll just do it again.
No, that dog ain't gonna hunt. I'm clearing free, not drawing again.
Yes, ma'am, I am. I am. Are you a nurse?
No, but I noticed someone forgot to bring your lunch in to you, and I wasn't doing anything, so I thought I'd just make sure you got this. Jell-O? So, Jimmy, tell me about yourself.
You mean how I ended up here?
Sure, we can talk about that, or whatever you want.
I had a dream once, camping with President Reagan. Nice guy. I woke up in the middle of the night to a strange sound, the sound of air being let out of 1,000 tires. And I opened the tent flap and saw thousands of snakes everywhere. They were all hissing, just hissing. The news reporters came and they couldn't see the snakes. Reagan got out of the tent and held a press conference, but he never mentioned the snakes. Were the snakes even real?
Well, it was a dream.
I looked in the reflection of a TV monitor, and I noticed I was also a snake. Maybe that's why I could see them.
Maybe.
You think I'm not making any sense?
No, that's not what I'm thinking.
This. None of this makes sense.
How did you end up here?
I don't know. I remember going to work one day and then waking up here. The doctor with the surgical sit-on told me I passed out at work. Said I have pneumonia, histoplasmosis, and something you get from cat feces. Now I know why people hate cats.
That's quite a list.
Have you heard of the gay cancer?
Yes, GRID. I've heard of it. You're gay.
Sorry, I guess I left my pink boa in my other gown.
My cousin's gay. He told me it wasn't that bad.
It's bad?
I mean that no one was getting it unless they were...
Unless they slept around a lot. I wish that was the case. What a waste.
What's a waste?
I loved him. I saved myself for him, and it did nothing. My love is the reason I'm here.
Your love was sacred. You didn't do anything wrong.
Do you know what will happen?
When?
The doc says I have moments. Moments like that dream where nothing makes sense. I don't know who I am or where I am, and he says I have some kind of dementia.
I'm so sorry, honey.
If I go totally crazy off the cliff, never to return, what happens? My spirit, my soul, is it let loose like when you die, or is it trapped, locked away in the mind or the body?
I don't know, but I'm sure someone will be able to help you.
You? Can you help me?
I can try.
I just want to see my mama one more time. Can you get her? Call her and let her know I'm here?
Of course, I can try. I'll go talk to a nurse.
You hold tight.
Thank you, Ruthie. I guess if my mom was coming, I have to spruce the place up a bit.
Excuse me, nurse. Excuse me.
Excuse me, did you just come out of the room with the red plastic?
Yes, I did.
You shouldn't have gone in there. That's a quarantined area.
Damage is done. Now, the young man just wants his mother to come visit him. Have you tried calling her?
Yes. He's been here for 6 weeks. No one has come, and no one is coming.
May I please have the number for his mother? Maybe I can talk to her mother to mother.
Ma'am, I cannot give you that information. And frankly, it's none of your business.
Is this his mother's number?
Yes, but you didn't get it from me.
Thank you. Hospital and your son. Hello? Mrs. Cook. Hello? Mrs. Cook. So sorry to interrupt your day, but if you hang up on me again, I will put your son's obituary in the Malvern Daily Record, and I will include his cause of death. Every busybody in town will know exactly how your son died, and they will know who was and wasn't there when he passed.
What do you want?
I just visited with your son. He's very sick, and all he wants is to see you.
My son died to me years ago. Whoever you have at that hospital, I'm not interested.
Excuse me?
My son chose this path. These are the consequences.
He just wants to see you. You won't even come say goodbye?
No, we will not. Also, when he does die, don't call back. We will not be accepting his remains. For us, nothing remains of James.
Jimmy is just out.
James made his choice! Now I've given you a fair amount of time. I thank you for the call, but we are done here.
Jimmy, I'm afraid I have some bad news.
Mama, I knew you'd come.
Jimmy, my baby boy, I'm here.
Mama, I'm so sorry. I did wrong. I didn't mean to. It just snuck up on me. If I had known this had another, I never would have done it.
Jimmy, no. You didn't do anything wrong. I'm sorry I separated us. I was wrong. But I'm here now.
Mom, I'm scared. I don't know what's going to happen next.
Here, let me wipe your face. You're sweating so much.
I don't want to die. I don't want to go to hell.
No one knows what comes next. No one. But I believe the good Lord will take care of us all. Jimmy, when it's time, I know it's so scary, but He will take care of you. I'll take you to my beautiful little cemetery where my daddy is buried. I know He'll watch out over you.
And you?
Me.
Will you sing to me?
What should I sing?
Remember the song I love to sing in the church choir?
You loved so many.
What a fellowship. What a joy.
Jesus, my Jesus.
secure from all alarms, leaning, leaning, leaning on the everlasting arms.
Jimmy William Cook. To be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord.
The Lord is my shepherd. I lack nothing. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He refreshes my soul. He leads me along the right paths for his name's sake.
Even though
I walk through the valley of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. Surely your goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever.
Amen.
So I would bury them in cookie jars, and that's what I did.
So you could write to family and friends. I even got stamps, and I'll run them by the post on my way home.
Oh, these are so lovely.
This one reminds me of my first Christmas without my daddy. We had had a major storm just a few days before Christmas, and my mama and I trudged through the thick snow to visit him. As we were catching him up on all the comings and goings, the sun broke down through the clouds and shined through the trees. It was beautiful. It looked just like this card.
So the cemetery, where your daddy's buried, is that where you...
Yes. That's where I've been able to bury those who needed help after they passed.
How can you afford those plots?
Oh, honey, I own them. 262 of them, to be exact. You see, there was this big family squabble, and my mama was not about to let certain members of the family be buried anywhere near her or her loved ones. So little by little, she saved up, and whenever she could, she'd buy a plot, starting near her parents and working out. Eventually, she ended up with most of the empty plots in File Cemetery and passed them down to me. The first person I buried, Jimmy, I buried on top of my daddy's grave so I wouldn't lose track of him. I just knew his mama was going to come to her senses and ask for his remains. That was almost 3 years ago now, and still no word.
How can people just entirely let go of someone they love like that?
It just doesn't make any sense.
Just heartbreaking.
I couldn't do what you do. How do you invest so completely in people you know you're just going to have to almost immediately say goodbye to?
Well, I don't look at it like that. No one knows for sure when their time will come. So I just want to help people and love on people as much as I can, in the hopes that by doing so, I can at least extend their quality of life, if not the length.
But my mother got mad at her oldest brother when I was 10 and bought 262 grave spaces in the cemetery so her brother and his family couldn't be buried with the rest of the family.
Okay, death certificate, declaration of durable power of attorney, living will. Luke, how are you?
Pretty good, I guess.
I hope you like pizza. I ordered a large, and I'm going to have to rely on you to finish it.
Well, I don't know if I can do that, but the slice sounds pretty good. What is all this?
It's just some paperwork we have to take care of before too long.
Why?
Just to make sure everything's in order, in case...
In case...
you suddenly take a turn for the worst. But we don't have to do that right now. Let's just eat first.
Thanks.
How are things?
Okay, I guess. Mconazole seems to be working, and it sure beats the amphotericin. I had an episode the other day. I decided to box up everything in my apartment and label the boxes with whoever was receiving the stuff. All that's left unboxed now is 2 outfits, the stuff in my fridge, and my toiletries. Living like a monk. I called my dad to see if he wanted to come over and pick up the stuff I set aside for him and Mom, and he said he needed to talk to Mom about it, and he would let me know. It was 4 days ago. Last night I called, left messages, and nothing. So, I took their boxes down to the alley and set them on fire.
Luke, that is not a proper way to handle things.
Oh, I'm aware, but it still felt really good.
What was in the boxes?
Oh, baby pictures, trophies, mementos of my childhood. Specifically, nothing that reminded them I was a homo. I wanted them to remember me the way they want to remember me. But not now. Don't ask what's in the boxes with their names on them now.
You never told me how it happened. Why you separated.
You know why. Do we really need to rehash that?
We don't have to talk about it if you don't want to, but I think stories, especially those that are so defining, are sacred and should be shared.
It was the summer of my freshman year in college. I was attending the community college in town because my parents weren't sure about sending me off to university. We were headed home one evening after the evening worship service one Sunday. While my parents had continued to discuss the topic the pastor had been preaching about. It was something about marriage being between a man and a woman, and homos being an abomination to God. 20 minutes of this conversation, and I just broke. Like a levee being pounded by floodwaters. It just spewed out of me. I don't think it's as bad as you all are making it out to be. I mean, I think I am gay. And silence in the car. It was never mentioned again. Yeah, I don't know if they think I'm going to magically be different one day, or if they even know I have AIDS. I just don't talk about it. By pretending this part of me doesn't exist, I've slowly stopped existing to them.
You exist? I can't make your parents change their hearts, but I will do everything I can to help you through this time. Which leads me to this stack of papers. Here, let's start with this one. This form allows me to make decisions for you medically in case something happens and you lose the ability to make those choices. Just fill it out and we'll go get it notarized tomorrow.
If only I could find a pen.
Anywhere I take someone with AIDS, the pharmacy, the doctor's office, the insurance company, anywhere, they refuse to take the pen back after it's been used. So I keep a collection here. It comes in handy.
Why aren't you afraid?
I was. Sometimes I am. But I know a perfect love, and it drives out fear.
Thank you.
Oh, my Ginger Rogers. Look at me in that swimsuit. If I was as thin as I am now back then, I would look good.
Well, except for all the spots.
Always a fly in the cream, but you're right. I'm like a Dalmatian, one sick puppy. Oh my gosh, who is that tall drink?
Spencer. I met Spencer in college. Great guy. We had a lot of fun.
Where is he now?
Passed away. Pneumonia. Well, AIDS complicated pneumonia.
So sorry to hear.
It's the song we keep hearing. Is this at the hot springs? You look happy here.
Oh, I look so young. That was only 3 years ago. That's Tim, Nathaniel, me and Christopher. We would escape to the hot springs all the time. Chris got sick first. It was so shocking. I think he was the first one I really knew who contracted it. By the time we all knew, it was too late. Chris was diagnosed first, but lived longer than Tim. I don't know what happened to Nathaniel. I heard his parents took him and wouldn't allow him to talk to anyone.
So much loss.
So many unfinished stories.
Okay, it's Christmas. Let's get off this one lane of sadness. And let's celebrate.
Said sure and climbed into his cab. And he asked me where I was headed, and I told him I lived over on Hazel. He asked me if I minded a detour, and I said why. He parked his car over by Hot Springs, behind the hospital. And as the windows fogged up, we... Darling, you made me love. And you.
Oh,
and Hot Springs. I love you.
Come on in, I'll be right out. I'm really glad you could make it.
Me too. How are you doing?
Oh, well, most days are hit or miss. I've been really depressed lately. Hard to believe it's been almost 3 months since I last performed my act. Wondering what kind of a queen levels out on stage with a cane.
You look as beautiful as ever.
Don't lie to a dying girl. I look like someone stole Joan Crawford's wax statue from Madame Tussauds and left it out in the midday sun.
That's certainly colorful.
Oh, always the entertainer.
You ready to go?
Yes. But before we go, I have something for you. I know it might seem a little bit weird, but this is my favorite possession on Earth.
Really, this is too much.
No. My most prized possession for my most prized person.
Billy, I don't know what to say.
McDonald's shakes might be a nice thank you.
You got it.
How are you so strong? Don't you ever want to break down from the weight of carrying everyone else's pain?
All the time, Billy.
Why don't you?
I have to be strong. I have to be able to let you do everything you need to do. So I just don't cry and I don't break down. Hey, how about those shakes?
Oh, I'd like that. Is it weird to have a favorite McDonald's? I love that on quiet days you can hear the lions purr.
It is nice. And with this breeze, you can't smell the elephants.
Did you know you can ride them?
The elephants? Think they'd let me up there in my dress and heels?
I think we'd have to find out.
Do you want to?
I do. I really do.
I love them. And I made sure that they were loved. They made so much more of my life than I made of theirs.
Hi, Billy. I'm Dr. Lewis. Looks like we have a bit of a collapsed lung and some pneumonia. We're going to fix the lung first. Then we'll get you on some new meds to deal with the infection.
Mrs. Thompson, this is Ruth Coker Brooks. I wanted to talk to you about your son, Billy. Yes, I know, and I realize that, but he needs his family. Yes, I care because someone has to. Your son weighs 55 pounds and has nothing. And you ask me when you're going to be able to get back to your life? Well, at some point, doesn't your mother's love trump whatever the pew warmers at the church are gonna think? Hello? Hello?
They aren't coming.
No, honey. They aren't. I'm sorry.
But you'll be here?
Of course. I took you for milkshakes and an elephant ride. I'm not moving from this spot until you return the favor.
Do you think it's weird to still believe in God after all of this?
No. Holding on to a belief that there's something greater than us out there, especially in times like these, is downright sane.
Do you believe in heaven?
I have seen far too much death to not.
Do you think I'm going there?
Yes, you're going to heaven. Bible says that wherever two or more are gathered and you ask for his forgiveness, he will forgive you. There are two of us.
Lord, I've come asking for your forgiveness. For whatever is in me that is wrong, I am so sorry. I didn't mean to make you upset. I was just living my life the best I knew how. Lord, I love you. Thank you for Ruth. Continue to give her the strength to be the strength for so many others. In your name, I pray. Amen. Sort of hoping that would bring me a miracle.
My precious boy, you are the miracle.
Ruth. I'm so sorry.
A woman, having an issue of blood for 12 years, spent everything she'd earned on physicians. They could do nothing for her. And she came behind him and touched the border of his garment, and immediately her issue of blood was gone. And he said to her, "Daughter, be glad. Your faith has made you clean. Go in peace." Billy, Elevator, you were so many things to so many people. In just a short time, you managed to make a lasting impact on every single person you came into contact with. Together, we searched and searched, never finding a doctor who could heal you. But I know, beyond any doubt, that you have touched the hem of his garment, and now you are clean. Go in peace.
Then I got another phone call, and then another. And then another, and they just kept coming and coming and coming.
Nobody wants to be the only one that's left standing.